was in the early hours of a summer's morning nearly 70 years ago that an unidentified flying object was spotted over Kent.
Diver, diver, diver. Northwest 101.
The descriptions at the time said the mysterious aircraft emitted a low, rhythmic tone as it flew. It travelled at a terrific speed with flames and bright lights trailing behind it. The year was 1944 and Britain was under attack by robots, the Doodlebugs.
The flying bomb, the V1, the buzz bomb. Call it what you will.
Germany's indiscriminate bombing methods run riot in the use of her latest terror weapon, the flying bomb.
They brought horror and terror to the people of Kent and Sussex.
Nazi Germany had finally unleashed its secret weapon.
The V1, the Doodlebug, was the origin of the modern cruise missile.
In the first week of June in 1944, Britain was euphoric. The successful Allied D-Day landings across the Channel in France, just 7 days before the first Doodlebug landed, had given the nation the feeling that at last we were winning the war.
But then the Doodlebugs were launched from secret sites along the French and Dutch coasts. Their target, London. But the first one was a little off target.
Luckily enough, it landed in open farmland in North Kent, but it was quickly followed by three other flying bombs.
One blew the doors off a pigsty in Sussex. Another landed in Platt in Kent. And the other made its way to Bethnal Green, London, and claimed 6 lives, the first fatalities of the bombings.
Well, at 04:30 hours on the morning of the 13th of June, the first V1 flying bomb to strike London landed here in Bethnal Green. And this presaged a major offensive, which at its worst was killing Londoners at the same rate as the worst Blitz of 1940 had done. The great legend of the V1s is that the fuel ran out and they came down. And it sounded like that. The thing was buzzing along with its pulse jet engine, and suddenly it would stop, and then the explosion would take place about 15 seconds later. What actually happened was that the missile had a guidance system. There was a little propeller on the front that was timed to go round a certain number of times, and when it had gone round a certain number of times, the elevators on the missile were altered and it began to dive. And as it dived, its fuel injection system couldn't overcome the force of gravity and the engine stopped. Oddly enough, the Germans spent a lot of time trying to stop that happening, but actually it probably had a greater morale effect because of this dreadful, ominous silence.
In total, 2,419 Doodlebugs fell on London, and the effect on morale there was devastating. The terror of the Blitz was still fresh in the minds of Londoners, and many people left the city, believing rural areas to be a safe haven.
But were Kent and Sussex any safer than the big city?
It dawned on RAF intelligence, the famous R.V. Jones, that actually, if you used our control of the German spies, we'd use that as a deception at D-Day. We had control over every German spy in Britain. And if we got them to send misleading information back home, the Luftwaffe would actually think that their weapons were overflying London and they would shorten the range. And actually, looked at coldly, it was better that they landed in the sparsely populated areas of Kent and Sussex than they landed in the more densely populated areas round here. Indeed, it's estimated that bringing the V1s down in Kent and Sussex, sometimes on houses and so on, actually saved probably as much as 50% of the potential casualties that might have been inflicted.
So the government was prepared to sacrifice the lives of those in the countryside for London.
We can for the first time publish secret films photographed at the killing grounds in southern England. The guns, first line of coastal defence, open up on a victim.
Intelligence plots, barrage balloons, anti-aircraft guns and fighter plane patrols made Kent, Sussex and Essex the three most dangerous places to be outside the capital.
When one nursery school in London was hit during the night, the officials took no risks and moved the children into the Kent countryside.
The children were moved to Weald House in Crockham Hill. On June the 30th, 1944, a doodlebug that had been flying overhead was shot down.
It had hit a tree, been deflected, and it hit a London County Council children's home. Those children had just been evacuated from London, and 22 of them were killed, along with 8 staff. They were all under the age of 2. And there were little bodies mixed up with all the rubble and debris, and the heavy rescue squad were there. It was just a complete, total tragedy. And it was actually Kent's worst incident during that period.
Ken Munday is 83 and has lived in Westfield in East Sussex all his life. Today,
he's tending one very particular unmarked grave.
Doris Lynch was 23 years old and 6 months pregnant when she died on the night a doodlebug hit Westfield, an event that was etched onto the memory of a 13-year-old Ken.
Suddenly there was this massive explosion. There was people and the emergency services were just arriving. Locals were digging at the rubble. Yeah, we stand there watching it all going on and that, but then suddenly, as they're digging around and found her, and the emergency service is only just, I don't know if someone, you know, tried to lift her too soon or something. Terrible.
It wasn't just the doodlebugs that were at the forefront of technology. The RAF's Gloucester Meteor was Britain's first jet fighter and had a unique way of bringing down the V1s. And one of the first doodlebugs the jet brought down crashed into this field at a farm in Headcorn near Maidstone.
This one was actually brought down by the Meteor pilot getting his wing underneath the wing of the flying bomb. And the flying bomb was actually controlled by a gyroscope. So if you could unsettle that, you could make the thing crash. So he got his wing underneath and literally tipped the aircraft, the flying bomb over, causing it to crash. And this tree, this oak tree, remarkably has survived the blast and it's survived the last 70 years. And if you look closely here, you can see the impact marks of the shrapnel from the exploding bomb.
And 70 years on, pieces of shrapnel from the exploded doodlebug can still be found in the fields surrounding the crash site.
That's a piece of flying bomb, piece of shrapnel from the flying bomb.
How do you know that then, Andy?
That's absolutely completely typical of shrapnel. You can see the way it's distorted and bent. I mean, that's been blasted into that shape. So that's a piece of the flying bomb that came down here in the summer of 44.
That's heavy.
It is.
Sharp edges, that could do some serious damage, just that bit on its own.
Well, I mean, there was approximately a ton of explosives and the flying bomb was literally shredded by the explosion, and this would have gone flying, you know, several hundred yards. So this flying through the air was lethal. You've got to bear in mind it was jagged, it would have been white hot with the explosion. Pretty lethal things, really. The whole of southeast England really is littered with these things.
On Friday, September the 8th, 1944, a rumour that Hitler had surrendered had reached London. People left work early, flags began to fly, doodlebug summer was at an end, the Second World War was at an end. Or was it?
At 6:43 p.m, a rocket crashed into Chiswick. Unlike the doodlebug, the rocket made no warning sound and took just 5 minutes to reach London from the Dutch coast. The V2 rocket had replaced the doodlebug and brought with it even more destruction and devastation.
Albert Speer, Hitler's architect, mentioned in his book that the V2s could have been fully operational at a much earlier date if they'd received more support from Berlin. If that had happened, the outcome of the war might have been very different indeed.